organization that now controls the west area in northern eastern Syria. She has been here for a week. She has been in some meetings with government officials, members of the Congress and the defense and the press U.S. press to tell what's going on the ground, the implications of the drones for people of northern Syria, Kurds, Arabs, Syrian Christians, Yazidis, Turkmens, what kind of consequences they might face. So her is such an important period of time. She also wants to get more clear messages from the administration. Like many of the people here, they are also confused about the statements. So she will elaborate more on her visit. But then also on my left, we have three guests from here, most of you know. So as you will get, David Phillips, director of Center for Peace Studies from Columbia University. He has recently been to Rojava end of December. So he has met with local Kurdish, Arab, Syrian, military, and political leaders. We also have a recent book. I also want to later on focus on this book about the U.S. Jewish relations. And Amy Holmes, she's a visiting historian. In Harvard University, so it's just me. So I'm also a fellow. As well, has been in Syria several times. She has done research on Kurdish female fighters. Also, she is focused on a new book about U.S. military presence in Germany and in Turkey. So she is also very informed about the U.S. military presence in the region. So we have opportunity to listen some insight from her as well. And finally, Nicholas Harris, Center for Strategic Studies. As well, he spoke on Syria. He's one of the active voices about the Syrian civil war and the war in the Middle East. He's also a fellow Jimmy Town Foundation. So once we listen to Ms. Ahmed, we'll continue with our guest. But please join me welcoming Ms. Ahmed. Please, Ms. Ahmed, we are over here.
First, I would like to thank America World Aba, Center for Democracy, to have this meeting.
Always are for end the war مجلس سوريا ديمقراطي سيوانك حموتي خاتين جدي سوري ورخصني سياسي في هنا. من پروژه سوریه دموکراتیک آر نناوندی مرکش خست و مخواستی ام وگه سوریه نو بیا پیشکش بکن و لجندشی داعش یه مشهره که به همکار کرد و حضاب نهاجی نتکاری و امتصال کرده این گلت مظلوم بده
هر واقع چه دیروز
هريم عفري هاي حبيت تزيد الفيديو.
They destroy all African history and they take all important things.
إيروجي جدنيا ربيجي أز جاك الموجودات الفرات هريم جاء أو داشي.
And now they tell the world that they have established a safe zone.
دخوازه هر کسی اقناع بکید که او یا دولتک باشه نبکره که گل سوری جنه خوریده و وانش خواهید
They would like to convince everybody that they are good and they would like to protect Syrian people.
بنابی که تروریست سوری هنه دخوازه بره ایرشی یعن شر تروریستا
Under the name of there is a terrorist in Syria that would like to come and fight the terrorists.
لنهام وقتی که هم زانن کاری که دولت تورکی دیده مشان
But we know what Turkey is doing is the terrorism itself.
We
said that the security and safety of this region should be protected.
یعنی به وکشی را بندر هره بدر تکیه چی نده ایروش چی نده؟
With withdrawal, it should be chaos for fight.
حمله به دشید باشه تمام بده.
And campaign against ISIS should be accomplished.
حیاب نواهین حجره الوازای بندره هره بدر گلو زنده هم.
There is a lot of sleeper cells in the region.
در این کشور نتیجه‌مان در دوام
می‌رود.
هر وقت آن چند دکتر شروع آبادی نتیجه چندی تکشی
نکنیم.
شبر کمر فراستن ام روحی که وقت ارکه تاسر من افان ام دبینن ام بیا دوام
And increasing the war.
hazır bu herkes Ali Karbiş bu karşıya katılayım da.
We need everybody participate in this war.
Proje siyasi avu hiç mefiş kısti evi o verin destekliyorsun.
This political project we have should be developed.
Rev peşiya siyasetem kartiren ejinu saydi veri götür.
And we have to stop the genocide politics.
Azadi gündür süreyle peker.
And freedom of
speech.
Takashin Bera de Wamar. The message is clear even if my pronunciation isn't. The Kurds have been struggling for decades, for centuries. That struggle isn't going to go away, even when faced with overpowering adversaries in Syria or in Turkey. And I'm pleased and honored to be a part of that struggle. I'm very honored to share the podium with Ms. Ilham today. Your visit to the United States comes at a critical moment when we're debating U.S. policy in Syria, what we should do to protect our partners with whom we have fought side by side in the battle against Daesh. As a result of your efforts here, there's now greater awareness role of the Kurds, about friendship between the United States and Kurdish Party. So we're very pleased that you're here to share that message. I also want to acknowledge my old friend Dr. Najmuddin Karim, who was with us today. 30 years ago, he came into my office with photographs of the victims from Halabja. And I've been a Kurdish activist ever since that day. And I can say that no person has done more over a longer period of time to raise awareness about Kurdish issues than Governor Karim. So when you came into my office 30 years ago, my life path was forever changed. So thank you for that. President Donald Trump made an announcement at the end of the year that Daesh was defeated. Well, if you ask the YPG or the YPJ or anybody here, we all know that Daesh isn't dead yet. And in fact, policymakers in the executive branch and on Capitol Hill are convinced that the fight against Islamist extremism is ongoing. According to the Director of National Intelligence, Dan Coates, ISIS is intent on reorganizing. There are still thousands of fighters in Iraq and Syria. The CIA Director, Gina Haspel, indicated that ISIS remains a capable terror group still plotting terrorist attacks. And even Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell asserts ISIS has yet to be defeated. These views were underscored by the attack in Monmouth on the 17th of January, in which four Americans were killed. A sustained and continuing effort against Daesh itself and its sleeper cells will be needed in order to establish conditions for security and political transition in Syria. The United States has established very close security cooperation with the Syrian Democratic Forces, which we all know at its core is comprised of Kurdish fighters, with the YPG and the YPJ. The Kurds have served as America's boots on the ground in Syria. As a result of weapon transfers and close air support, Kurds were able to defeat the advance of Daesh against Kobani in 2014, to liberate Tal Abyad in 2016, to drive Daesh from Raqqa, itself declared a caliphate in 2017, and more recently to drive Daesh fighters out of in early 2018, the U.S. announced plans to deepen security cooperation through the establishment of a border security force that would include 40,000 SDF members. You will probably remember President Erdogan's reaction to this announcement. He said the border security force will be stillborn, and he would strangle it before it had an opportunity to fulfill its strategic task. President Erdogan vowed to attack Afrin, an oasis of tranquility west of the Euphrates River, and then he said that the Turkish forces and their proxies, the Free Syrian Army, would pivot to the east. They would cross the Euphrates River and establish a security corridor all along Syria's border with Iraq. All along Syria's border with Turkey up to Iraq. On the 20th of January, Turkey launched an unprovoked attack against Afrin. The aerial bombardment was the first phase of an ethnic cleansing campaign aimed at changing Afrin's demography by expelling Kurds from their homes and replacing them with Arabs displaced by Syria's civil war, and also planned to Turkify the town of Afrin. I was very privileged to visit Misra in December and attend a conference there organized by the Rojava Institute of Strategic Studies. I also had the chance to speak with victims from Afrin who told horrific stories about their personal experience. I was with my old friend Bernard Kushner. We heard from a woman who was the co-chair of a local council who fled their homes in Afrin. She described the conditions of the aerial bombardment. Then the decision after 58 days to flee the city. This woman was as strong as can be until she told the story of leaving Afrin, walking hand in hand with her teenage daughter until a Turkish missile came and blew her daughter to bits. So all that was left was the mother holding the arm of her dead daughter. Now, I have twin daughters who are 14 years old. I have to tell you that nothing would be more horrible to me than seeing my child victimized anywhere, but certainly victimized by Erdogan's criminal regime and his FSA gangsters who committed terrible crimes against the people of Afrin, killing, raping, beheading, mutilating the bodies of YPG
recognition of the friendship and partnership the United States enjoys with the Kurds in Syria. The attack on Afrin was the first phase in a campaign to change the region's demography. The bombardment lasted for 58 days. Hundreds of civilians were killed, nearly 1,000 members of the YPEG and YMJ also died. As part of the plan to change the demography, 300,000 people were driven from their homes in Afrin and fled to Tilbury Fop and the Sheva regions. Turkey and its FSA partners committed genocide and crimes against humanity, as defined by the Geneva Convention of August 1949. It conducted indiscriminate bombing of civilian settlements, massacring members of an ethnic, denominational, and belief group. It violated the Geneva Conventions of 1951, which makes collective punishment a war crime in Article 1, and criminalizes violence against national, denominational, and religious communities in Article 2. The campaign, which was intended to Turkify Afrin and change the region's demography, is just the first phase in a broader campaign whose sole goal is to kill Kurds. Everyone calls them terrorists, says that the YPG is affiliated with PKK, even though U.S. law clearly distinguishes the two organizations. They may share an ideology, a spirit, but their command and control is distinct. And this is just further evidence of Erdogan's atrocities, not only against the Kurds in Syria, but against his own citizens, Kurds in Turkey, who have suffered terrible abuses over many decades. Students were forced to carry the Turkish flag in Afrin. The Free Syrian Army required children to appear in videos thanking Erdogan for, quote, liberating Afrin. They plundered private homes. Street names were translated into Turkish and Arabic. Civilians who remained in Afrin were forced into madrasas, providing radical religious education. Women were required to wear a veil. The Yazidi people were forcibly Islamicized and required to attend religious services. Those who remained behind in Afrin were beheaded. The Yazidi women and children were subjected to harassment and rape. Turkey is often given a pass. It claims, as a NATO ally, it deserves special favor. But let me say clearly and without hesitation that NATO is more than a security alliance. NATO is a coalition of countries with shared values. And because Turkey is Islamist, anti-American, and hostile to human rights, Turkey applied to join NATO today, its application wouldn't even be considered. So no more special treatment for Turkey and its criminal leadership. In the wake of President Trump's announcement, I came to Washington last week and I could see there was a consensus emerging among U.S. officials about how to respond. Of course, any security policy needs to be demand-driven. So the objectives that I heard from senior NSC officials at the State Department and on Capitol Hill were clear, limited, and precise. The United States wants to continue its campaign to degrade, defeat, and destroy Daesh. People that I spoke to want to make sure that the Kurds in Syria, who are friends of the United States and are battle partners, are not thrown under the bus and betrayed. don't have a plan for stabilizing Syria, northern Syria in particular, the hard-fought gains of the YPG and YPJ will be lost. So let me, in all modesty, present to you a four-point plan that the United States could pursue. We know that constant pressure is going to be needed to destroy that. We also know that the SDF and the YPG are capable security partners. They've proven that as a form of the spear in many operations. Also, we know that the Kurds have self-interest in vanquishing the Islamic State. But they need the tools to do the job. So the United States should continue to provide heavy weapons, including offensive weapons, to the Syrian Kurds as they continue to prosecute their battle against the Islamic State. We should also continue to provide close air support. What we saw in Afrin was evidence that without air power, Turkey is a third-rate military. And its jihadist proxies, the Free Syrian Army, are simply criminals out to better their positions. Let's take love. So in addition to the security cooperation with the SDF, the U.S. should continue to control the airspace of the northern Syria. Now, I deliberately don't use a word like a no-fly zone, because I remember John McCain saying how complicated it is to apply a no-fly zone. But in fact, controlling the airspace over northern Syria will prevent Turkey's air power from coming in. It will enable a free fight, a fair fight on the ground between the FSA and Syrian Kurds. The FSA are gangsters out for self-gain. The Kurds are family members defending their homeland. So I have no doubt what the outcome of that fair fight would be. The third element of this plan is to deploy international monitors. Now, we need to recognize that for months, U.S. officials have been telling the Syrian Kurds that the U.S. would withdraw. And the U.S. is not going to stay deployed in Syria forever. We know that a time will come when the U.S. is going to withdraw its special forces, the 2,200 of them there now. So as the U.S. withdraws its troops, I recommend that international monitors would be rotated into northern Syria. We already have British and French personnel on the ground. Other countries would contribute personnel as well. And these monitors would serve as a tripwire and deterrent to Turkey's aggression against northern Syria. And U.S. personnel can also stay involved. It's important that there be international witnesses on the ground so that Turkey is not given a green light to commit its heinous crimes. Now, how would we establish international monitoring mission? We could do that through a resolution of the UN Security Council. If Russia opposes it and vetoes it, which it may, then a coalition of the willing could be established with countries that are like-minded and that are part of the global coalition fighting Daesh. I believe, however, that Russia would agree to an international monitoring mission because it doesn't want to surrender Syria to Turkey, which is fundamentally adversarial with Russia's interests. Now, this plan to stabilize northern Syria add a political component. If we're going to achieve any kind of sustainable peace, there needs to be negotiations between the government of Syria and Kurdish representatives. Now, I was told at the White House, don't even bring it up. Nobody here has any appetite for promoting. dialogue between Damascus and the Kurds in Syria. Well, it's time for a more reality-based approach. Believe me, as a human rights activist, nobody is more horrified by Assad's crimes than myself. At least I am as horrified as anyone. But the sad reality is that Syria has won the war, and there needs to be a modus vivendi among Syrians. And that's going to require some dialogue between Damascus and the Syrian Kurds. Now, the UN has appointed a very capable new special envoy, diplomatic Geir Patterson. I've known Ambassador Patterson for 20 years or more, and we've discussed the situation in Syria. It's critical that the U.S. provide deeper support and engagement to U.N. mediation efforts. Smart, strategic, and sustained engagement United Nations and a coalition of willing will enable the U.S. to achieve its security and humanitarian objectives while creating an opportunity to stabilize northern Syria, giving momentum to more effective diplomacy. If there can be a power sharing deal between Damascus and the Syrian Kurds, it devolves power from the capital to the regions, that will build momentum other parts of Syria towards a similar kind of agreement. And we know that ultimately a peace agreement with Syria is going to look a lot like the Dayton peace agreement for Bosnia, a central government with limited powers, authority for security, economy, local governments, and culture devolved to different regions. And before surrendering the microphone to Amy, I just want to say one more thing about my trip to Rhodesia. I love being there. It was a great experience. What I saw in Rojava was a sense of unity. Kurds, Arabs, Yazidis, Christians, coming together behind a common purpose. In fact, it reminded me a lot of the kibbutz in Israel in the 1950s and 1960s, people working towards a greater society. So I have very high regard, not only for the Rojava experiment, but for the extraordinary sacrifice that the YPG and YPGA has made in service of America's interests in Syria. And I put the question simply to the administration. After throwing the Syrian Kurds under the bus, after standing behind the want Iraq policy and allowing Iran to invade Kirkuk, who is going to respond the next time the United States asks for help? We need to be loyal to our friends instead of trying to placate our adversaries. And as a friend of the Kurds, I'm here to pledge my loyalty to you and let you know that whatever we can do to raise awareness and mobilize support, we will do, because the cause is just, the people are good, and it's in America's interest to maintain its friendship with the Kurds in Syria and to stand behind the Kurds in Turkey. And gradually, as the Iraqi Kurds very much for coming to Washington. Thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this panel. Thank you all for being here. I look forward to continuing our discussion.
Where the Kurds, Arabs, Christians, Yazidis,
type of society, beautiful society, unfortunately, right, as you mentioned, the local people are vastly displaced. As Peter has watched and the international, widely mentioned in their reports, the atrocities are widespread, the looting, kidnapping, ransom, torturing are going on. I think they will address one of the reasons why people are of other parts are horrified. What happened to our brain? Really horrified. And still, that same thing might happen to Kobani, Lundich, Kamsho, maybe. So, sadly, what happened to our brain?
Thank you, Mutlu, and thank you to the organizers of ARCA for inviting me and for organizing this conference while Mr. Ilham Ahmed is visiting us here in Washington, D.C. I think it's very important. There were, of course, a number of private events, as many of you know, different think tanks, but I think it's important to have a public event like this one as well, particularly because the situation in northern Syria is very critical and we're at a very critical moment in time. Now, David and Ilham have already outlined many of the important issues that have been discussed over the past week during her visit and also prior to that. I'd like to add to the discussion in two ways. Now, as you all recall, our policy actually had three components. Ambassador Jeffrey, the special envoy to Syria, has enumerated this many times. So the three components were, first of all, as we know, an enduring defeat of the Islamic State, not just the physical caliphate, but an enduring defeat. Second, to contain the spread of Iran. And third, to resolve the Syrian conflict according to the UN Security Resolution 2254. Now, first of all, what I'd like to add to this discussion is that there's been a lot of focus since Trump made the announcement about the troop withdrawals after the phone call with President Erdogan in December. There's been a lot of focus on the issue of the ground troops, of the 2,000 or so U.S. Soldiers, which are currently stationed in Syria. But we do also, as David indicated, need to consider the issue of airspace. Now, Brett McGurk, after he resigned, he wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post where he also advocated for maintaining access to the airspace even after those 2,000 troops are withdrawn. So, whether or not we call this a no-fly zone or we call it something else, the point is that the U.S. has already been coordinating with Russia to access the airspace over Syria in order to prevent any hostile encounters, which has been successful and which has actually worked quite well since over the past few years along this deconfliction line. So this kind of coordination with Russia and with Turkey should continue. Now, this is something that we could discuss, as we mentioned in my book, where I've written about 7 decades of U.S.-Turkish security relationship, the history of the U.S. military in Turkey since the end of World War II, since 1945. Of course, there have been many ups and downs in the relationship. There have been many crises over Cyprus, for example, in the 1970s. And then the U.S. arms embargo after Turkey used U.S. supplied weapons to invade northern Cyprus. So there have been a number of difficult moments in the history of the U.S.-Turkish relationship, but we've always resolved these crises, and I am hopeful that we can also resolve the current current disagreement over the situation in northern Syria. Now the details of accessing the airspace, again, this could be worked out. It's not an issue of access to bases in the region. That could be done, you know, relatively easily, also without interlink from bases elsewhere in the region. But the issue is we have to come to a political agreement, obviously. But the second and the main thing that I actually want to talk about here is that going back to the question of the enduring defeat of the Islamic State, and again, not just the physical caliphate, but the most important way to ensure that this defeat is enduring and not temporary or ephemeral is to make sure that the ideology, the Islamist extremist ideology, is defeated. Now, the best way to do that is to invest in education. Now, because as long as the belief system of that Kurds or Christians or Yazidis or women are inherently inferior, as long as people believe this, the possibility that Islamic State or some other jihadi version could reemerge will always be there. So by investing in education in schools in Northeast Syria, this is, I believe, the most important and the most effective way to ensure an enduring defeat of the Islamic State, not just in Syria, but also in Iraq. Now, this is also what the region of Northeast Syria lacks. There is not one single university in the Kurdish region of Syria. The regime of Hafez al-Assad and Bashar al-Assad never created a university in Northeast Syria as part of their discrimination towards the Kurds of Syria. There's a university in Aleppo, and there's a university, of course, in Damascus and other parts of Syria. But even after the creation of private universities in the mid-2000s, I believe, there was never a university in Kamishli, for example, or Kobane, or any of these parts of the Northeast. So now some of you may say, well, it's unrealistic to now talk about establishing schools or universities while the conflict is still unresolved. But I would beg to differ. And I would say that it's not just that it's not unrealistic, but that it's a necessity. And that, in fact, it's happened before. If we look to the Kurdish region of Iraq, in 2006, the Board of Trustees of the American University of Iraq in Suleimani got together and decided to open an American university in Suleimani. Just 1 year later, in 2007, AUIS, the American University of Suleimani, opened its doors to a cohort of 10 students from across Kurdistan and Iraq. Since then, since 2007, AUIS has expanded. They now have a center for the study of ancient Mesopotamia, a center for regional studies, a center for peace and security studies, an institute for regional and international studies. And in March 2013, they hosted the first annual Suleimani Forum, which has since then become a flagship institute, the flagship event of the institute. Perhaps some of you have attended the Suleimani Forum. I was there in 2017. It attracts leading scholars, policymakers from around the region and from the United States, including some of the most prominent experts at various think tanks here in Washington, D.C. attended the Suleimani Forum in 2017. So the beginning of the Suleimani Forum was just 6 years after AUIS was founded. So the university is only 12 years old, and they've already, I think, have quite an impressive track record. Now, they also, for example, have a degree program now, a law program that collaborates with Stanford Law Department, etc. So, but the point is that this university was created in 2006. They opened their doors in 2007. This was the year of the surge. The conflict in Iraq was not over yet when they started this university. A second example, the American University Ahmed is the second oldest English language university in the Middle East. It was founded in 1919, so this is our 100th anniversary of the American University in Cairo. The oldest American university is in Beirut, founded in the mid-19th century. Now, AUC has continued to operate and hold classes despite all of the turmoil that's happened in Egypt during the so-called Arab Spring. I mean, as I said, I've been a professor there since 2008, so I lived in Cairo and witnessed all of this firsthand. The revolution, as many of you know, in Egypt began on January 25, 2011. That was actually when the spring semester was supposed to start, because normally our spring semester starts at the end of January or February. So because the whole country was in the midst of the turmoil and the revolution, classes were postponed for about 2 weeks. Now, if you recall, Mubarak actually finally stepped down after being in power for 30 years on February 11th. So we're almost at the 8-year anniversary of the end of the Mubarak dictatorship. So he stepped down, he gave a television interview or a television address of Omar Suleiman, actually, where he announced Mubarak was finally going to relinquish power and step down. That was in the evening on February 11th. On the morning of February 13th, so less than 48 hours after Mubarak stepped down, we started teaching again at the University of Cairo. We were expected to go back and start the spring semester. And so I remember on February 13th, because I had stayed in Egypt through the entire period. Some of the faculty left the country, but I stayed there throughout everything. And so I got up in the morning on February 13th, and I went to teach my class. And I didn't know, actually, if anybody was going to be there, because I thought, you know, many people had, some people had left the country. The situation was still very unclear. Is Mubarak really going to, is he really gone? Is he going to come back? You know, who exactly are these people, the Supreme Council of Armed Forces that were running the country? Everything was a bit, you know, the situation was still very uncertain. And yet, I walked into my classroom on the morning of February 13, and to my amazement, the classroom was full of students. My Egyptian students were like, yeah, we overthrew Mubarak the day before yesterday, but now I want to go back to class and study. So what I'm trying to say is that despite all of the uncertainty and the turmoil in Egypt, with the not just in 2011, but remember, the mass protests continued. In 2012 and 2013, there were mass protests again, then against the SCAP, the Supreme Council of Armed Forces, and then again against Morsi. The military intervened again, there was a coup, there were massacres in Cairo. Right? The American University is located in Cairo. All of these events happened in Cairo. I'm suggesting to create a university in a relatively safe part of northern Syria. In Kamishli or Kobani, or you know, you could decide where the best place would be to create it, but the fact is that AUC continued to operate despite all of the turbulence in Egypt since 2011. Now you might say, well, Syria is different than Egypt, and it's different than Iraq. The Kurdish region of Syria is also different than the Kurdish region of Iraq. However, as we know, the northeast, currently under the control of the SDF, is relatively stable and relatively safe. When I visited Kobane in 2015, the first thing they wanted to show me was a school that they had created. That wasn't actually what I went there to study. I was going there to interview the YPG and the YPJ, but the, you know, the people there were like, no, actually the school works. And they took me to a container, you know, because many of the buildings were destroyed because of the airstrikes, but they had some metal container, you know, where they were all having classes. So this is something, you know, education is something that they also want and that they value. Now, if we don't, for example, if the United States does not support the creation of the University of Northeast Syria, maybe the regime will, maybe Damascus will finally decide it's time that there should be a university in the Kurdish region of Syria. But then, I would imagine the classrooms will get filled with muhadarat. Intelligence agents that report everything back to the regime. So that would not exactly be an environment conducive to learning or critical thinking. Or maybe the Islamic Republic of Iran would create a university there, which I guess would probably also not embrace academic freedom or freedom of expression. So my suggestion is that there should be some university in Northeast Syria. They're trying to create one, I believe, they're calling it now Rojava University, whatever you call it. The idea is that it should be based on the idea of freedom of expression, academic freedom. It should be open to women, men, Kurds, Arabs, Christians, Muslims, Alawites. It should be open to everyone based on a secular education system on the liberal arts model, and should embrace the ideals of academic freedom and freedom of expression. Now, the United States is supporting, perhaps some of you know, the rebuilding of Mosul University in Iraq. Mosul is the second largest city in Iraq. It's largely destroyed, of course. It was the capital of the Islamic State Palestine in Iraq. Now that Mosul has been liberated, they are also rebuilding the university in Mosul. And the United States is helping with this. So my suggestion is that we should also do the same in Northeast Syria. Now, who could teach at this university? I mean, again, these are details that would be worked out. At the American University in Cairo, where I teach, about 60-70% of the professors, the faculty, are Egyptian. 30-40% are American, European, from other parts of the Middle East. So you could have, you know, 60-70% of professors there from Syria, but also from other, other countries. For example, some of the professors at Turkish universities that have been purged, both Turkish and Kurdish, you know, maybe they would be interested in having to teach there. If everyone doesn't like the idea of those academics coming and teaching in Northeast Syria, then we would also consider rehiring them in their previous positions at Turkish universities. Turkey also has very high standard universities. I have a lot of friends who teach there, so those, you know, the point is that the university that I'm proposing should be internationally accredited, that the faculty would need to have PhDs, that it would be based on a liberal arts model, and most importantly, have institutional autonomy from the regime in Damascus. And so that means that the regime would have no say in who gets to teach there, or who gets to study there as students, or what is taught in the classroom. So it would be institutionally autonomous from Damascus. Now, these values of freedom of expression and secularism and religious freedom are values that the SDC themselves embrace. So these are not ideas that we're imposing on them, but they're ideas that they themselves have been actively defending for the past number of years. Now, of course, in order for a university or a school system to operate or to have a chance of succeeding, the region needs to be stable and safe. This could happen, again, with the presence of international coalition forces, as David suggested. We don't have to be American forces there, but I believe a U.S. presence with some American leadership would be important, because this coalition now of 75 countries that are in the coalition to defeat Daesh came together because of American leadership. And so some, you know, continued U.S. leadership of this coalition as a monitoring force on the ground, I think, would be important. Thank you.
I invite you to the podium. I want to bring our audience to thank everybody so that today the coalition the Turkish YPG represents the most experienced program and most capable portion of the SDN intelligence of the UOG IGP General. His paramount stability and efforts of white ISIS in the Middle East increases value. While it is experienced with Irish ISIS along with US recruitment and the training to the SDF over a number of years, is paramount stability efforts to defeat ISIS. So this is the coalition, global coalition, tells the DOD IG. So starting from here, if you want to comment, please, the podium is yours.
Thank you.
Arabs who were there to work as gas workers because of the promise that their country had made them wasn't doing themselves, which of course led to the Afghanistan. Thank you for your question. I'll just start out by saying that we need to understand that the relationship between the United States and the SDF or that wasn't something that was intended. It was something that developed organically and naturally. This is a very key point. For the better part of a decade, many different parties here have tried to shoehorn the relationship between the Syrian opposition, particularly the armed opposition, and the United States to their detriment. What developed, what has developed between the US military, the YPG, others that have come together to form the SDF has been the result of a battlefield experience, has been the result of the US policy that never intended to be in Syria in the first place. And least of all, and one of the purposefully developed, at least dramatic areas of the country. This is important for us to understand the dilemmas moving forward in the US as it considers its policy, not only towards its partners and allies in the SDF, but also towards Syria as a whole. The US never intended to be in Syria, never intended to control almost one third of Syria's territory through its partnership with the SDF. And it never intended to have all this potential leverage on the ground and upon the future of Syria through its relationship with the SDF. What is clear, however, is that this relationship that has formed, that has developed, left a great impact on how the U.S., particularly the U.S. military, but also other elements of the U.S. government use its future role in Syria and in the Middle East. The fact of the matter is, if there was no SDF, the U.S. would have to build one. We forget that when the U.S. first engaged in the Contra ISIS war in 2014, it was on the searching for partners. It was because it had an effective partnership by the Burkana Amurat operations group, of which the YPG and YPJ was a clear backbone of the operations group, that it had the opportunity to abide with them through local Syrian partners to accomplish objectives. This is important. U.S. policy is moving away from expensive and large engagements in the Middle East. Policy is moving forward towards engaging with local partners. Partners that can provide security and can provide the elements of stabilization that are needed to prevent Daesh from returning. This is providing security, governance, administration, and hopefully economic reconstruction and access to humanitarian assistance. As the U.S. has worked with the SDF and built it up, it has also come into reality that there is no easy solution to put Syria back together. Syria is a geographic space. It is no longer a unitary state. It is no longer a state that can be dominated from one capital to Damascus. This is why the SDF model has appealed to Americans and their own policymakers, and it is why we have the U.S. so invested in engaging with the SDF, even with all the potential benefits it would have by turning back to Turkey. And this, the reason for that is the SDF is in such a good partner. So now the question that we face before us is that President Trump has made it clear that he wants to see U.S. forces respond to the Iraq and Syria. But that wish can only be fulfilled with a stronger SDF. There is no other competent local partner force that has the security bona fides necessary to prevent the reemergence of Daesh. We see that in the press release from the very singular that clearly. But there's a greater challenge than just defeating Daesh from that point. It's how do you build a new social, political, and economic order in one of the most underdeveloped and underprivileged areas of Syria to serve as a model for the rest of the country. This is the challenge moving forward, and this is the demand that will be placed upon the SDF by not just the United States, but by other coalition partners. And this is with this challenge and opportunity. We are seeing now, live,
us unfolded before our eyes the development of the democratic society. We are seeing it field tested. We are seeing it being demanded upon by international actors. It's a difficult challenge, but it's one that can potentially be overcome. But it will require the investment of the U.S. and other coalition partners to strengthen elements of the SDF and SDC's governance. Its ability to provide administration, its ability to provide humanitarian assistance to internally displaced people, and its ability to treat and actively engage with the future government in Damascus that takes seriously the people of Syria's demands of decentralization and autonomy. So from this, when we look forward to what can be accomplished and what can be achieved, we have to realize that it won't occur overnight. That with the type of investments the United States can have a long-standing consequences in Syria. By investing in the SDF and investing in its opportunity to make it a more diverse and a more effective organization, the U.S. can potentially help provide that post-ISIS stabilization that's needed to prevent return engagements and return conflicts against Daesh and prevent Daesh or its successor to Daesh from trying to do what it did to the people of the Middle East in the first half of the conflict. That having been said, we do ourselves a disservice by just making this a situation in which the Syrian Kurds who are getting it. What we're talking about here is a movement that is trying to be popular and responsive to local demands. And there are many local demands. It was never intended when this ISIS war started to see the expansion of the SDF overall on top of there as well as other areas such as Manish. It's there, that this is the reality of the place. And so the United States intends to see this part of Syria, for lack of a better term, its part of Syria stable and conducive towards a future settlement that prevents the geographic space of Syria from being a source of instability and a safe haven for terrorist organizations moving forward. There is only one pathway for it. And that's by making the SDF the best model it can be for future scale. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Great. Helpful. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have a brief presentation by one of our guests, Doreen Homer. And then after that, we have a Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's great to be part of this discussion and panel. My name is Lauren Homer. I'm an international religious freedom and human rights activist based here in D.C., and I'm part of something called the International Religious Freedom Roundtable. We meet regularly with the ambassador at large for International Religious Freedom, Sam Brownback, and as a group, a multi-day group of many different organizations from many different parts of the world, we work together to bring religious freedom, which is the foundation for all of democracy, to various places around the world where there are problems. I'm happy to say that sitting here are some people from Kurdistan who we see regularly and from other groups. And we have just issued, and there are copies available, my colleague Hilda has some, a letter to President Trump that went to him last Tuesday. In which we asked the president not to abandon the Christians, Yazidis, and Kurds in the Syrian northeast. Now, as probably all of you already know, in 2013, these different people groups set up under a social contract a democracy, which is pretty much just like what we have in the United States. Everybody has equal rights, but it goes beyond that. Women have the right to have the ball to government jobs. By my friend Ilham here. So this is unheard of in the Middle East. This is the only place that it happens. And in 2014, we began urging the Obama administration to get behind this area, and particularly to provide the security it needed as it became obvious that ISIS, well, first ISIS self-declared, but of course there months later, the administration had adopted many of these policies and did decide to invest in the SDF and ARMET and protect it. And it, we can't emphasize enough, it's multi-religious, it's multi-ethnic. So we did a second letter this September to Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and the asks again were very similar to those of other speakers have mentioned, and it looked like the administration had accepted these requests, and of course we're not the only ones asking for this, up until the day that the president announced his troop pullout on December 19th. So now we have another letter addressed to him, and we are asking, first of all, that no Turkish troops be allowed inside the northeast of Syria. We're very clear on that. They can't come in to some little area. They can't come in by proxy, by having people put on committees in local councils. They can't come in because we have the proof of that. We know what they've done there, and it is a genocide. My colleague here, Gregory Stanton, is the president and founder of Genocide Watch. They did a declaration of genocide on Afrin, and they had issued a warning already for the Syrian northeast. So they can come in. We need to provide alternative security for an enlarger staff, either whatever we want to call it, security in the air, security on the ground, maybe other members of the anti-IS coalition could be there, but not Turkey. Then the second thing is that the Syrian Democratic Council must be included in any peace talks on the future of Syria, any constitutional discussions. We can't have a situation, which is what happened have now, between the Assad dictatorship and Islamic tyranny, and they're the only people at the table. They have a pluralistic model that works, it's battle tested, and it should be the model for all of Syria and maybe all of the Middle East. And then that's our third point. They've got to be able to take their advantages. And the idea that the U.S. can pull out any degree of honor is a huge mistake. It's a moral injustice to abandon our partners in the field of battle, and it's a moral injustice to allow the crushing of this one place in the Middle East where its people have decided to share power and have democracy and equal rights for all. Thank you.
Mutlu, hand your mic. Hand your mic. For both of them. Mutlu, you may have to hand that one up. Yeah.
About the safe zone and protecting our ports.
were Palestinian. They are Muslim. Yani Palestinian had the church of Buddha,
but
in the
But we think if the protection stay in just war, would be good.
The way mechanism of Palestinian
should be the mechanism of for that.
Which is really good, which is what we think about the
He talked about the skills of continuing the communication, how that can be formatted.
There was a Turkey vision, Murat, and the vision not.
Turkey government says we have to do it and we say no. We say the skills should be for the whole and people in the region.
And the basic question.
We and the coalition forces have to work on that line.
Yani dediğiniz ve göre ziyaret ama ilk bedeli kalmıştı. Nasıl demek ki sürekli müdürsü bir dengeye çiğdiye.
In this visit, I recognize and I feel that there is more the understanding of the situation of the county in Syria.
Herkes bir doğru akordan verildi.
Everybody knows about the Kurdish demands and...
Zannet ki devlet de Türkiye gibi bir şey kadar tekrar
You know that put a last cause and they would like to keep it.
Hışkara o nizi rastiye yani işte bu şey.
But the thought of that so the society is alive and aware about what's going on. And this give us hope.
Well, the big people it is this at all our young and vision to have all of the love of the Sarah Chavez to give to the
Krishna. And we hope that this new year, 2019, will be a solution for all of us.
Thank you very much, boss. Thank you very much for your presentation. Have you met with other U.S. officials besides your meeting at the hotel with Trump? And if you have met with those officials, can you tell us anything about those discussions?
Believe it, it's not about Trump or the inconsistency, right? Everything you have to do, everything you have to do, everything you have to do, everything you have to do,
everything
you have to do, everything you have to protect the area, what is needed?
Well, the Congress energy, yani bu vaccine ettiğimde zaman bu çevre ve bu değil, bu kadar ne
kohandı? We feel that in the Congress to withdraw in a good way should be a plan.
Bu kartları büyük ne ve misal burada o kartları verildi ve hışkara yapıyor.
And to prevent genocide against courts and people of the area, there is awareness about that.
Yani ben şimdi bir kart, bu Amerika, bu geri Amerika, işteci, bu şekilde bir an kabul.
Withdrawing without plan, it is not good for America.
For
America. They fought together in the front line together, and now they have been abandoned and they give the pilot safe to fire. American community, American society, and American government have to have awareness about this.
It was reported in the press that President Trump told you that I love Kurds. I would be skeptical about President Trump's love for Kurds. In my view, he loves himself, the last person he spoke to. I don't think that he is a loyal partner to the Kurds, as evidenced by his recent remarks. I also want to talk about Iran and echo a piece that I had in the Jerusalem Post about Iran's role in Syria. If we withdraw from Syria, we are essentially surrendering to Iran control of territory from which they can ship weapons and attack America's other ally in the region, which is Israel. Iran's strategic goal is to be able to send weapons through a corridor that stretches from Iran through northern Iraq and northern Syria to Hezbollah for its operations in Lebanon and to Hamas. When you're speaking to U.S. officials, I think it's very important to recognize the very deep partnership that exists between the United States and Israel, and how Trump's stated position of withdrawing from Syria undermines Israel's security interests at the same time as it betrays our Kurdish allies. And I'd be happy to give you my piece in the Jerusalem Post, because you might want to extract some ideas from there in your future discussions in Washington.
Introduce yourself, Mr. Khan. I know you're for the audience.
Thank you. In honor of the Turkish journalist, just put two questions about the safe zone. US talks about the safe zone and the Turks talk about the safe zone. What's your understanding about it? Apparently, the talks are still ongoing right now. Today, the presidential spokesperson said there is still no deal. What is the sticking point as far as we can see? And the second question is, what is the Russian role there right now? Do you see the green light for Turks to go and take over about 5 kilometers they talk about? Would you be okay with 5 kilometers of safe zone if Turks or Turkish-backed militias are taking over the city of Kurdistan? Thank you.
Gerek yerin hani harema öyle harema diyecek.
Her
evet basit şekilde.
Evet.
For us, the security and safety of the video is very important. The Murat will actually achieve a significant minister who joined the mission to the academy for the Jasa Telegraph.
What happened in Athens should be repeated again and they give permission to Turkey to come in. This sample, this what happened is very bad in American, in Turkey, in Turkish history, and it should be repeated again. That why any sample under Turkish control is not acceptable. But to protect the border between the North Syria and Turkey, there is some element being done. There is some discussion about this. They talk about safety or security both sides in Syria, Syria part and Turkish part. But Turkish knows more than other ones that there is no attack on our border. That's why the protecting north and east Syria from Turkey is more important. Recently between Russia and Turkey, they mentioned about Adana agreement. What happened? What's going on between Russia and Turkey is exceeded or beyond the Adana's agreement. In eastern the Turk entered like more than 40 kilometers in Syria now. And they are there. But Adana's agreement says go and withdraw
up to 5 kilometers. Up to 5 kilometers.
As soon as the American coalition is there, there is no any
I'm coming prepared to the game, but I would like to sometimes but you could act as but David, it's coming to the all the great coming to our feeling. Why is that very important? You mentioned you call it the genocide or something you call that, but some people want to again mention that. So why is that very important? Why is that really not great? Could you please elaborate on that?
So the operation against Adana that started on January 20th reveals the true face of the regime in Ankara. Racist, chauvinist, and it's driven by an obsessive desire to kill Kurds. Anyone who opposes the government of Tayyip Erdogan is considered a terrorist. Yesterday he made a statement and he said the PKK, the YPG, and the HDP now are all terrorists. So Turkey's economy is in trouble. The U.S. should be focusing on measures it can rescue it. And it should make clear that when we talk about controlling the airspace, that the U.S. is prepared to shoot down Turkish planes that come into Syrian territory.
You said, my name is Khan Zulama, I'm with the American Kurdish Information Network. You spoke fondly of what has been created in northern Syria in Rojava, and you said the rest of Syria should follow it, should emulate it. President Trump, unfortunately, sees in Syria just, as he put it, sand and death. He calls, I'm wondering what President Putin thinks of the Rojava experiment. That has been created in northern Syria. Does he appreciate it? Does he hear your message? Or will he side with President Bashar al-Assad? Bashar al-Assad?
We asked Russia to play a role among us and not just support it, but the regime say be like water. Not be on the side in the regime side.
Thank you.
الشاب بدأ المقص
right the safe zone that the Turk would like to really control it, it is open a door for a new crisis and it is reverse the war in the When Daesh ISIS attacking Kobani, Erdogan made a speech over from the press and said that Kobani is fallen. Yemeni was protecting Kobani. But the Turkish would like that. They have like more, they have like the size when they say Daesh is going to control
Kobani.
This people displaced or pushed.
Tomorrow they want their own
their property rubber. This time, if something like that happens, that means that we will get back to the start point and there will be a big chaos.
All
in all, we can emphasize that the Syrian democratic forces is a democratic process and they increase. They fought about the Nusra front and they win or defeat him. They defeat they fight against Daesh and they win. If there is another attack on the regime or another forces, they will
rise.
Because they can't protect that Everybody knows or agrees that the Syrian democratic forces should remain and should continue on.
Greg Short, gentlemen. Yeah, you.
I'm a journalist with the German Federation. I just wanted to ask if you could update us about the status of your negotiations with Damascus and whether you believe that in the end there's more likely to be a deal with Russia and the Syrian government.
With the regime, we try to have dialogue for a political solution. We try with Russia as well. But we haven't seen anything about the resolution or about the solution. There is talks or statements.
America
until now, they haven't talked about the political solution. They put their own, what they have, they emphasize on force or military. They track the
اجبوی زدن کو ملف سیاسی هر دست روسان رژیم و ایران
We see that the solution should be Syria and Syrians.
Thank you so much. It's good to see you all. My name is Cameron Erickson, and actually we had the opportunity to meet in 2017 as I'm the delegation of political consultants. And I think you were in Soleimani, so. So good. Thank you so much for coming to Washington. It's been said, David's mentioned it, and it's been alluded by the rest of the panel about the negotiations with Damascus. And the goal is clear that you want territorial autonomy. My question is, what would the framework of the negotiations be, and what would be in Damascus's interest? How would this be a win-win for both parties? And then secondly, I was just wondering what the role of the KRG is in all of this. Thank you.
Yani çaresini yavrum çaresini sesini haber vermek için ve yalda aranı bu proje mi işbirliği?
The political solution between us and regime, we give them a list of 10, 11. To have a good solution, they should be the most part, they should be convinced that they want a solution. From the region's side, we haven't seen any approach to dialogue. They look how they can bring their control on Syria. For that whole effort for solution doesn't work out. The role of Russia is very weak. Russia has to make pressure on them to be convinced that there is no way of the solution. They have to have the Kurdistan government, unfortunately, they have yesterday they have met with the group who project their position. This group who supported the invasion of Turkey to Afrin, and these people made a statement in Kurdistan Parliament and saying that
Yani
Somebody else needs to be in charge of the security, because you have faculty that can go there and work full time. And also for the students to return.
Syrians that have fled into neighboring countries, for example, some of them want to return to Syria in order to come back to the school, in order to encourage them to do so, those schools and universities would also have to have international accreditation. That's why some students, they may like to come back, but if they don't have accreditation, then they prefer to go to the university outside that does.
I also wanted to ask you a present draft comments on destination in case of any sorts of the ISIS power forces go back to Syria. I want you to comment on that.
Sure. Okay, so I just wanted to just highlight this as outstanding point that you're making. There's a lot of concern about the potential relationship moving forward between Damascus and Afghanistan. So when I talk with NGOs on the ground in northern eastern Syria, particularly that those that deal with education, civil society, capacity building, to every organization highlights this issue. One of the most important types of power that Damascus has over the people of northern eastern Syria is the credit nation of their police. There is a large youthful population in northern eastern Syria, and their current to have accreditation in their professions, particularly technical professions, medicine, engineering, water treatment, and others that are key to build, rebuilding, and constructing something better than it's ever been. Not only just in northern eastern Syria, but in Syria at large. Right now, that power rests in Damascus. And so until there is a mechanism in place to accomplish exactly what you're talking about, there will always be a weapon that Damascus can use against the people of northern eastern Syria. Very quickly, in regards to President Trump's comments, and the fact of the matter is, there's an active debate right now in the policy process about how to maintain a U.S. presence in northern eastern Syria that does not require, as he phrased, uniformed American personnel. There are many different ways that you can accomplish a U.S. presence, both remotely via Iran potentially, but also on the ground in Syria. There are many different permutations of that. That decision isn't made yet. But we should all look for how that plays out. And at the bare minimum, if the United States is going to be able to continue to impact events on the ground in northern eastern Syria to support the stabilization mission, the coalition needs to maintain control of Peshawar. If the coalition withdraws from Peshawar, there is no support for the stabilization mission unless it intends to keep air bases that are combined with mail on
because of maybe Erdogan and political parties power in Europe to create the issue. To the other country like France facing a very technical protecting the interests of Northern Syria.
As well that the French people, they were very helpful, especially when the Turkic pressure was. And they have a role in the war on Daesh. What the understanding from them, they would like to stay.
bu harem Aras tipinde muhafaza kurulu oldu.
To protect the region, they would like to have a law.
Neyince mekanizma ve geçişi vazifelerle ki tatavana karşı bir yaratılmıştır.
But the mechanism and the details of this is not clear yet.
For the part of Turkey and the effective value of the we all know that since Kobani, the US forces have collaborated and worked closely with SDF, and we have seen the outcome of this collaboration with SDF and the US forces. What surprised me is that when you say that politically, the US is not engaged. For the last couple of years, U.S. civilians who have fought state battles in the SAID are going to Syria, and I'm part of that change. I don't know how come there is no political engagement between the local government or the northern Syria government with these diplomats and politicians under the development. To put up the universities and schools. And the question is, what have you done? Do you know that there is US civilian politicians and diplomats on the ground?
We have political discussion always there, even in the political side.
The diplomat,
the
one that everyone is
seeing. They have diplomats, they have political representatives there.
The ground is full of the European and
the framework, they work to. Support the project and the continue what is being established. What mission about the engineer
negotiations?
As you know, Syria is part of the process.
Yani rebeli yapmışlar, cesadisi halka sürü kontrol.
The Syrian management and the situation, they control 30% of the ground in Syria.
Rebeliler göre dışarı seviyor.
But they don't have any representative in the solution.
Gerek Amerika'da sektör.
Amerika should support this.
Okay, the last questions, please. Last two questions, then we're going to have to close the statements. Yes, please.
My name is Cüzander Simon, and it's my honor to have you here in Washington. And as a Kurd, I appreciate myself your effort defending the Kurds. My question is to you and to David as well. What is the situation of the border between Rojava and DRC? It used to be closed. I'm wondering if it's closed, and if it's closed, what is the purpose of the border is closed?
It's
I know David knows the area very well too. If it's closed, why it's closed? What is his idea if the border is closed?
He says
open.
It's
open.
The answer to your question is it's open but highly regulated. So you just can't show up and fish the port and get on the pontoon bridge and go to Syria. There's a lot of permitting and paperwork, but it is open.
The reason I asked, I was there in Kurdistan two, three times, once in 2012 and 2013, and I wanted to visit Rojava, but the border was closed. As an American Kurdish American citizen, they do not let the festival.
It'll be closed after this meeting.
So my question is a policy or a solution focused thing. I want to know how does decentralized governance impact the provision of internet services in New Syria? Is there an innate cybersecurity that can be used to help with the provision of educational services, international monitoring? How does the decentralized governance impact the provision of internet services, in particular IP addressing schemes? There could be a very strength in that, having a network that is more resilient to attack in case one node goes down.
Essentially meaningless. So it's absolutely essential that we support think that that should be also part of our agenda, part of our discussion, and not just on the this military domestic.
The risk of self-promotion. I have a new book. It's called The Great Betrayal, How America Abandoned the Kurds and Lost the Middle East. Somebody asked me, how did you write a book in 2 weeks? In fact, this is really a book about a century of U.S. betrayals, and it focuses on the events in Iraqi Kurdistan, and it warns that the Kurds in Syria might suffer a similar fate. Let me just say a brief remark about education. There's been lots of study and analysis about de-radicalization strategies. And people look at education, it's an important component. Economic development is another important element. I have a bias about freedom and democracy. I think the best antidote to Islamist extremism and democracy for people. So if the Kurds can be a positive model, that will have a positive effect in North and East Syria and in the country as a whole. One of the criticisms that's leveled against the Syrian Council from time to time is its inclusiveness and its willingness to involve a range of Kurdish parties and others. So I would just urge you and your colleagues to make a point of being democratic, transparent, and inclusive, which I know is your intention. It's going to be an important point to emphasize in Washington and in other capitals, because they want to view Rojava as an alternative to the Ba'athist Arab chauvinism that exists in the rest of the country.
Gentlemen, before I give the final words to Ms. Ahmed, I want to thank you very much for being here. Thank you for the great panel. We've learned a lot from rich opinions, both from Syria and from US perspective. I see there is an agreement that the defeat of ISIS is not over. Today I talked to some highly senior commanders of SDF in the region.
We thank you all for coming to this meeting. Thank you.